All right. Thanks a lot for the kind invitation to lecture in this school. It would have been so much nicer to not do it through an iPad, but actually on a blackboard. But I guess this is what it is. So my plan for these lectures was to first review some basic aspects of quantum information theory, basically in the setting of quantum mechanics. And that will probably take most of the lecture today. Before tomorrow, I move on to aspects of entanglement in quantum field theory, where there will be many differences compared to the quantum mechanical case. There are many reasons to talk about quantum entanglement and quantum information theory and all that. And obviously, this is an important part of modern quantum computer building business. One reason why in high energy physics we like quantum information theoretic tools is, on the one hand, that it allows us sometimes to give general proofs of certain statements that are very difficult to prove otherwise. There's, for example, a statement which is called the average null energy condition, or also known as the ANEC, which is a statement that in quantum field theory, this is also not good. As you see, I'm a bit amateur. It's a statement that in quantum field theory, in any state psi, that the integral along a light direction of the plus plus components of the stress tensor is always largely equal to zero. So this is an exact statement in quantum field theory. And one way to prove this statement is to use quantum information theory techniques. And it's a very remarkable statement in quantum field theory, because the expectation value of the energy momentum tensor at a single point can be arbitrarily negative. That's maybe not true in a classical field theory, but in a quantum field theory, the stress tensor can become arbitrarily negative. However, if you integrate the stress tensor along a null ray, then it turns out that this expectation value is always non-negative. And this is something, one of those general, say somewhat more abstract statements that one can prove using quantum information theoretic methods. Also, the methods of quantum information theory have been very important in modern studies of especially black hole physics, and in studying processes like thermalization. So thermalization is the process where you excite a system by pumping energy in it, and then you let it go into thermal equilibrium. And the exact way in which it settles in thermal equilibrium is a process which is called thermalization. And to study such types of processes, quantum information theoretic techniques are also very useful. But to start, let me review some basic properties that we will need. So the typical situation we'll be looking at will be quantum mechanics for now. So later we will go to quantum field theory, but today we'll do quantum mechanics. And we'll typically look at systems where the Hilbert space can be decomposed into pieces, HA, tensor HB. And what you should have in mind is simply say a box where we have a subsystem A and a subsystem B, where HA are the degrees of freedom living in subsystem A, and HB are the degrees of freedom living in subsystem B. So rho AB will be a state. So this can be a mixed state in HAB. Let's call this HAB. And this can in general be a pure state, and it can be a mixed state. One question we can ask, let's for the time being think about pure states. If we have just a pure state in this Hilbert space HAB, as you remember from undergraduate quantum mechanics, there are two types of situations. This pure state can be a product state, in which case it can be written as a state in A times the state in B. And if that's possible, then you call it a product state. And if that is not possible, you call the state entangled. And one very important feature of entanglement is that it means that measurements that you do in subsystem A and subsystem B, the outcomes of measurements will be correlated if you have an entangled state. And that's not something you have in classical mechanics. In classical mechanics, if you separate a system in two subsystems and you start to do measurements, you will never have correlations between the measurements. That is something that's forbidden by classical physics. And one of the main awkwardnesses of quantum mechanics is the fact that you can have this notion of entanglement, and therefore you can have measurements in two different subsystems, even if they're light years away, that are correlated. I'm sure you've all heard of the of an EPR state. So it's a standard state, for example, the classical example of an entangled state. Oh, this is really annoying. Suppose you have two qubits with states 1 and 0. And we have a state like this. And this is a state that has entanglement between system A and B. And as I'm sure, again, you all know, if you measure the qubit in subsystem A and you measure the qubit in subsystem B, even if these two systems are very widely separated, then you will always find the same result. So the outcomes of these measurements are perfectly correlated, and this is only possible if you have an entangled system. Now, one important question that one can ask is, in general, if you have a state in a Hilbert space HAB, is there a quantitative measure of the amount of entanglement that there is in the state? Is there such a quantitative measure of the amount of entanglement that is in a pure state between two subsystems? That turns out to be a very difficult question, and there turn out to be many different quantities that one can write down that are an attempt to quantify the amount of quantum entanglement that one has between two subsystems. And none of these entanglement measures, as you could call them, is completely satisfactory. So they all have particular properties. You can even try to write down axioms that you would like your entanglement measure to obey. So you can try to axiomatize it, and then you can try to classify all possible things that obey those axioms. This is all very complicated stuff. We will mostly be talking about the simplest possible maybe measure of quantum entanglement, which is the following, which is called entanglement entropy. And it's a direct generalization of the ordinary notion of entropy from statistical physics. What's the idea? So we take a state rho on HAB. And the first thing that we do is to go to the reduced density matrix rho A. So there's a certain procedure to go from a state on a bigger system to a state on a smaller system. And basically what happens is that this reduced density matrix rho A is defined by the property that if you compute, if you take an operator that lives only in subsystem A and does not live in subsystem B, and you compute its expectation value in the larger system, we want that this expectation value is the same as the expectation value as computed in a smaller system. So in other words, this reduced density matrix rho A has exactly the same information as the full density matrix in the bigger system AB, as long as you compute expectation values of operators that only live in A and not in B. So if you insist that this relation that I wrote down is true for all operators in A, then it defines this quantity rho A, which is the reduced density matrix for rho AB with respect to the subsystem A. In general, if rho AB is a pure state, then rho A can be an entangled state. Sorry, if rho AB is a pure state, then rho A can be a mixed state. And this reduced density matrix is the thing that you will use to quantify entanglement. Let's first try to write down an explicit expression. So suppose we look at this equation here. Suppose maybe if I turn this around, maybe it works better. This will work a bit better. If you look at this equation here, let's try to work out a little bit what this equation entails. So suppose I write rho AB in general. Well, I have to expand it in a complete set of basis states. So I'm going to write this as a sum over I, j, k, l. This is all a bit complicated, maybe. So this is a complete expansion of any density matrix in a system AB in terms of basis states of subsystem A and B. So it's an object that has basically four indices I, J, K, and L. Now, if you compute the expectation value of an operator that has only support in A in this mixed state, so if we compute something like this, so this OA will only have matrix elements in subsystem A. So if we take the trace over the full system AB, in system B, nothing much happens. It is just taking the trace. There's no operator in system B. So that means that basically this rho A that you get, you can obtain by simply tracing over the B system. And that leads to the following expression for the reduced density matrix. Where, as you can see, this is now a density matrix that only lives in the subsystem A. And as you can also see here and here, we have traced over the indices in the B system. So it is now true that if you take this quantity rho A, it is indeed true. And if you want to convince yourself, you can work out the steps in a bit more detail. It's now true that this reduced density matrix has exactly the same information as the full density matrix, as the full state, as long as you do computations only in subsystem A. So this notion of a reduced density matrix is very important. You can also try to define something like a reduced density matrix in quantum field theory, and we'll see examples of that later. Where again, it's some sort of mixed state, which you can use to compute correlation functions in a subregion in space in your quantum field theory. In principle, we can define these reduced density matrices whenever we have a tensor product factorization of the Hilbert spaces. These tensor product factorizations can be complete abstract tensor product factorizations. They don't have to have any reference to a geometry or spins or anything like that. Any abstract tensor product factorization is in principle okay in order to do this formalism. And as you can see, to go from here to here, we put this index j and k equal to each other and we summed over those indices. That's why it's called taking a partial trace. we're not taking the full trace. That would mean summing over all the indices, but we sum over some of the indices, and that is why this operation is also often referred to as taking a partial trace. Now, given such a reduced density matrix, we can now define the following object. And this is called the entanglement entropy of subsystem A. Now, this is just some weird expression, minus trace rho log rho. You may wonder where this comes from. Well, first of all, it has a few properties. So first of all, if rho A takes the form of 1 over z, if it would happen to take this particular form, in other words, if rho A would happen to be exactly the state that you would use to describe finite temperature quantum mechanics, right? What's written here is a finite temperature state, and the expectation value of an operator in quantum mechanics in this state is precisely the expectation value at finite temperature. Yeah, this is quantum statistical mechanics. So if you take rho A to be a, if it would happen to be a conventional thermal state for some reason, then S is the usual entropy. That is familiar from statistical mechanics. But more generally, what is this quantity? First of all, it is a bit funny because it contains the logarithm of a matrix. You can ask, how do you take the logarithm of a matrix? But in general, we can always diagonalize rho. Write it as a diagonal matrix with some unitary transformation. And then it's pretty easy to see that this S of A becomes the following expression in terms of the eigenvalues. It is simply is a sum over minus lambda of I times the logarithm of lambda I. So this expression here is probably the easiest to remember. And one thing you can see from this expression is that if rho A is a pure state, that means that rho A only is one state. That means it is of the form psi psi. Then it has one eigenvalue 1 and all the other eigenvalues are 0. And then S is equal to 0. And this is what you might have thought, because if you start with a state and it is a product state to begin with, and you go to the reduced density matrix, it remains a pure state. And for a pure state, there is 0 entanglement. And indeed, this entanglement entropy, as computed in this way, ends up being precisely 0. So if you start with a state psi AB, which which is the product of two states to begin with. So this is what we call a product state. It doesn't have any entanglement. And you compute a reduced density matrix in the way I just described. In this case, you find it is simply given by psi A, psi A. This is just a matrix with one, if you diagonalize this object, it's already diagonal as it's written. It has one eigenvalue 1, it has many eigenvalues 0, and you find that the entanglement entropy is equal to 0. Well, let's now do an example. Suppose we go back to our previous case, which is like a standard entangled state. This way. Let's just slowly compute reduced density matrix and see what we get. So the reduced density matrix, the full density matrix in the original system is psi psi. Well, you need to work this out a little bit, but if you do it all, it looks like this. Screwed up here. Yeah, sorry about that. Look something like this. So this is just what you get if you write the bra and the cat and you multiply it out, right? You get four terms like this. And now we need to take the trace in the B system. So let me put the B's here. So if you now take the trace in the B system, you see that here there is no contribution to the trace because it's 0, 1, there's no trace. This does not contribute anything. And the other things do contribute something. This one gives 1 and this one gives 1. So if you put that all together, the final result that you get is that rho A is equal to 1/2 0, 0 plus 1, 1. And this indeed is not a pure state. This describes a proper mixed state. In fact, this object has two eigenvalues, lambda 1 is 1/2 and lambda 2 equals 1/2. Because if you would write rho A in a matrix form, it would simply look like this. So for this particular case, the entanglement entropy is minus 1/2 log 1/2, minus 1/2 log 1/2, and that's equal to log 2. And if you have like a single EPR pair like this, which gives rise to a mixed state of this form, then you get an entanglement entropy of log 2. So you could say that S is a measure, or it's counting the number of EPR pairs that are shared between system A and system B. That's a pretty crude statement, but that's roughly how you can think about it. So this is an important little computation. Now you may wonder, if you go back to this original definition here, where does this come from, this minus lambda I log lambda I? So it's a bit of a long story to explain why you want to look at this very particular combination of lambda I log lambda I. This happens to be the same combination as what is known as Shannon information. So Shannon tried to develop a theory of classical information already many decades ago, and he invented some quantity called minus the sum of pi log pi, where the pi's are classical probabilities. And it has to do with a question that well, sometimes the simplest way to think about it is, suppose that you have lots and lots of little marbles that all have different colors, and you randomly draw marbles from this face and you put them back, and then you get a series of colors like red, blue, red, red, green, red, blue, red, red. You can ask how much information is in that string of colors. And you can argue, and it's basically a combination that involves binomial coefficients, you can argue that the amount of information that you get is less if you have larger fractions of certain colors in it. Let me give you an extreme example. Suppose you have 99 green balls and one red ball. Yeah, so we have 99 red and one green ball. Now, if you start to draw random balls from this face and you put these balls back, then the typical outcome will be many, 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 many red balls with an occasional green ball. Now, what is the most efficient way to describe this final outcome of this process? It is not by giving the actual series of colors. It is not by giving an endless list, red, 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 green, red, 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 and so on. It's much more economic to just say at which positions the green balls arise. So like the first green ball was in place 150, and the second green ball was in place 350. And the third green ball was in place 600. And if you describe the outcome in that way, then that's a much more economic way to represent the information in this string of balls, rather than just giving what it literally is. And this whole idea that you can represent the outcome in a more economic way, that is a concept of information compression. So the outcome of this random experiment can be compressed. The information in it can be compressed in this particular case by just saying explicitly where the green balls arise as you do this random process. And then you can think a bit more about, yeah, how much, what is the most economic way to represent the outcome? And if you think about the most economic way to represent the outcome, then you're automatically led to representing everything with some binomial coefficients, and then you do some asymptotics, and then you arrive at this particular information theoretic quantity. So it's also a measure, the entanglement entropy in some sense is also a measure for the extent to which the information in the system A can be compressed. Yeah. And it's a nice computation to work that out in a little bit more detail. One important feature of entanglement entropy is the following. So suppose that we start with a pure state. If you start with a pure state in HAB, then the claim is that SA is equal to SB. In other words, if you compute the reduced density matrix of subsystem A and compute its entanglement entropy, or you compute the reduced density matrix of subsystem B and compute its entanglement entropy, the results will be the same. Which is useful because you would imagine that what the question you're really interested in is how much entanglement is there between A and B. And if that's the question that you're asking, then ideally there would not be a difference in whether you compute it using A or whether you compute it using B. And that's indeed true as long as you restrict your attention to pure states in HAB. How do we see that this is true? Well, for that, we're going to use that up to unitaries, any state psi in a tensor product decomposition admits something can always be decomposed in this way. You can always find a basis in subsystem A and a basis of states in subsystem B, so that any pure state can be written in this particular form. This is called the Smeed decomposition of the state. I'm not going to prove it. The proof is pretty straightforward. Basically, what you do is you write your full pure state. You expand it in an arbitrary basis. Then it will look like a rectangular matrix. And then any rectangular matrix, you can basically diagonalize. If you have a rectangular matrix and you act on it with unitaries, you can diagonalize it in the sense that you occupy only the diagonal until you hit the bottom of the matrix, and then everywhere else you will find a zero. So there's also a version of diagonalization for rectangular matrices. And if you use that, you will find that any state psi in this Hilbert space HAB can be written in this particular form. But it's probably reasonably intuitive. And if HA and HB have the same dimension, this is nothing but diagonalizing a square matrix. So now if you use this representation, then you find that rho A is equal to the sum over lambda I squared, well, I should say absolute value squared to be precise. And similarly, rho B will be look like this if you compute the corresponding reduced density matrices. And if you have never done a computation like that, I would encourage you to take this example and to work this out in some more detail. So here is row A and row B, and now you see that row A has exactly the same eigenvalues. Row A is already diagonal, and row B is also automatically diagonal because we started with this state psi in this Schmidt decomposition. You see that the eigenvalues of rho A are absolute values of lambda I squared, and the eigenvalues of rho B are the same. And since they have the same set of eigenvalues, if we plug it into this expression for entanglement here, which is just given in terms of the eigenvalues, we'll automatically get the same answer. Now, if the state is not pure, if you start with state that's not pure, then SA need not be equal, and in general will not be equal to SB. And this is one of the reasons why, in some sense, entanglement entropy is not the best possible measure of the amount of entanglement between A and B. And a very simple example where you can see this happens, that is to suppose that rho AB is the tensor product of two density matrices. If rho AB is the tensor product of two density matrices, then each of these density matrices can have separate entropy. They could, for example, be finite temperature states with some temperature. So this can have an arbitrary SA, and this can have an arbitrary SB. So if you start with a state that's the tensor product of two density matrices, and you compute entanglement entropy of subsystem A and of subsystem B, you will get two different numbers, but neither of these numbers tells you anything about the amount of entanglement between A and B. In fact, in this particular case, although you get some number as A and some number as B, there is no entanglement between A and B because you start with the tensor product of two mixed states. So this is one reason, in fact, why entanglement entropy is not such a great entanglement measure to begin with. If you look at people that try to approach entanglement entropy in a more axiomatic way, for example, then one of the first things they would impose if rho AB is the tensor product of two density matrices, then this entanglement measure should vanish, because clearly in this case there is no entanglement. You can try to improve the situation a little bit and come up with a better measure that does not have this particular problem. And that quantity, which is in some sense an improved measure of the amount of entanglement, the number of EPR pairs between a system A and a system B, is a quantity which is called mutual information. So the mutual information, the setting is precisely the same. You have a system AB with a subsystem A and a subsystem B. The mutual information between A and B, and the notation is IAB. So the definition of this, it is SA plus SB minus SAB. So what this tries to do is it says, well, suppose I have a state on a system and I have two subsystems. I compute the amount of entanglement in subsystem A and the amount of entanglement in subsystem B, but I subtract the total entropy in the combined system. if you want to have a cartoon, so let me draw some EPR pairs, which I will draw as two dots with a little wiggle in between. You can have much more interesting entanglement patterns in quantum mechanics. But these represent, this is just a cartoon, right? Sometimes it's helpful to have these little cartoons in mind. Here we have a system A, and here we have a system B. Now imagine that these dots with a wiggle in between, it's an EPR pair. So each blob is a qubit, and the wiggle means that we entangle these two qubits. Now, in this case, what would S of A be? In this case, S of A, it would count this particular entangled thing. This is a pure state. It will not see it. It will not see this. Well, this is actually not such a good example. I should have done this differently. Suppose that this, let me write this differently. Suppose here I have some thermal crap. And suppose here I also have some thermal stuff. So suppose this is some finite temperature stuff. And suppose that this is also some finite temperature stuff. That has a lot of entropy. Now in this particular case, S of A will be the S of T of A. So that's the finite temperature entropy of blob A plus 2 log 2, because there are two EPR pairs here and here. And each EPR pair contributes log 2 to entanglement entropy. But there's also this big thermal piece here, which is annoying because, as you can see in the picture, this thermal stuff has nothing to do with the amount of entanglement between A and B. And then S of B is equal to the thermal entropy of this blob in B but again, plus 2 log 2, because of these two EPR pairs that are really properly entangling A and B. And then the total thing, the total entropy of the system is given by the thermal entropy of A plus the thermal entropy of B. And that's it, because each EPR pair by itself is a pure state. And pure states do not contribute to entanglement entropy or to entropy if they're entirely in a single system. So if you look at the full system, these EPR pairs do not contribute. But if you look at subsystems, they do. So now you see that what happens is that if you compute mutual information and you plug in these three relations here, you see that all these thermal things cancel each other. And the only thing that's left is a mutual information, which in this case would be 4 log 2. So in this case, all this annoying feature that ordinary entanglement entropy has, they are no longer part of this computation, because now we're doing things with mutual information. So mutual information is a better entanglement measure than entanglement entropy itself. Nevertheless, we will very often be using entanglement entropy rather than mutual information to do various computations. Now I should maybe say there are many, many interesting properties that entanglement entropy satisfies, and I will list a few. This will not be an exhaustive list. I already explained to you that if psi AB is pure, then SA equals SB. Another interesting statement is that the total entropy, the total entanglement entropy of the full system is always less or equal than the sum of the entanglement entropies of the two subsystems. This is usually called subadditivity. And it in particular implies that if you go back to my definition of mutual information here, it implies in particular that mutual information is always non-negative. So this is an equivalent way to write this notion of subadditivity. And of all the different weird other things that there are, I'm only going to give you one more, which is relevant if we have a case where we start with an Hilbert space HABC, which can be decomposed into three pieces. And in this case, there's a relation which is called strong subadditivity. So it's stronger than number two, hence the name strong subadditivity. It's the rather peculiar and not very intuitive statement I don't know, it's hard to have any obvious intuition for what this statement means right now. It is just some strange statement, an inequality that states that the entanglement entropy of system A plus that of the full system ABC. Actually, I see that this is not quite correct. It should be like this. If you take the subsystem B and you compute its entanglement entropy and you add that of the full system, it's less or equal than that of AB plus that of the BC subsystem. Also, this relation, it's not only not very intuitive right now, and maybe it will never be very intuitive. It's also hard to prove in some sense. So you might think, well, how difficult can it be to prove these relations? Suppose that HA is two-dimensional, HB is two-dimensional, and HC is two-dimensional. And suppose you take some mixed state on HABC, so the total dimension of ABC is 8, 2 times 2 times 2. So take an 8 by 8 matrix, compute its eigenvalues, and then compute all these reduced density matrices, which will be 4 by 4 or 2 by 2 matrices, and compute their eigenvalues. And this is a statement about eigenvalues of finite dimensional matrices. I would then always think, well, you know, how difficult could it possibly be to prove a little theorem about eigenvalues of matrices? Well, it turns out that even if these Hilbert space dimensions are 2, it's very, very difficult, unless you're very smart or incredibly sophisticated, to just prove this particular statement using sort of plain vanilla estimates of matrices. It's really difficult. I will also not prove it, that's beyond the scope of these lectures. But I will say a bit more about, I'll give a different interpretation of this strong superadditivity statement later, where it will at least become a bit more intuitive from a maybe physics point of view, why something like this might be true. Oh, and the last one I want to mention, but that's really kind of a different nature, is the following thing, which I also won't prove. Is the following statement. So suppose we have a system AB. And we take two operators, one in system A and one in system B. Then you can prove the following inequality between, on the left-hand side, mutual information, and on the right-hand side, correlation functions of these operators. Maybe I didn't write this very clearly here, but what we have in the numerator is the square of the connected two-point function. So we take the two-point function OA, OB, and we subtract the one-point functions OA and OB. Now, this connected two-point function, so the two-point function minus the product of the one-point functions, such a two-point function measures correlations between system A and B. If there is no correlation between system A and system B, then the connected two-point function must be zero. So if you have a system that does not have any entanglement between A and B, then this connected two-point function must be zero because there's no correlation between A and B. This is a more precise statement. This particular expression here states that the square of the connected two-point function can in fact be bounded by mutual information. So it's a peculiar relation between an actual correlation function and a quantum information theoretic quantity. And as you can see, if in particular the statement is that if the mutual information vanishes, which is the statement that A and B are uncorrelated, there's no entanglement between A and B, then this inequality immediately implies that the connected two-point function of any pair of operators in A and B must be identically zero. But more generally, you can try to use this relation to put bounds on correlation functions in subsystems if you happen to know how much entangled they are. So if you have two systems and they are slightly entangled, you cannot make these connected correlation functions arbitrarily large. So that's kind of an interesting relation between correlation functions and a quantum information theoretic quantity. which I again will not prove. In fact, I don't think I ever tried to prove it myself. I imagine it not being totally impossible, but I never tried to prove this myself. Let me see. So maybe it's 11-ish. Maybe this is a good time to break. It's also a great time to ask questions. You see, it's a very lonely business to lecture to a screen with no faces. So it would be great if there would be any questions. At least I would have the impression that people are listening.
Okay, Jan, I will pause the recording. Thanks a lot. Maybe people, let's see. Pause. Okay, it's recording.
All right, then I'll continue. I'd like to, before continuing, introduce a few other concepts. So there's a huge variety of other, as I said, of quantities that measure entanglement and so on, and other more general things that you could call quantum information theoretic objects. There are too many to go through all of them, and also we won't need all of them, but I'll mention a few important concepts. So one is called relative entropy. Relative entropy is defined as follows. So it's a function of two states, not one state. And it's defined as the trace of rho log rho minus rho log sigma. So this looks a little bit like entanglement entropy, but now there's a trace rho log rho and a trace rho log sigma. A few things to note about relative entropy is that it's not symmetric under the exchange of rho and sigma. So it's an asymmetric object, which is perhaps slightly peculiar. But it's also a nice object, and in many ways it is much more fundamental than entanglement entropy. This is perhaps the most fundamental and basic object in the whole quantum information business, this notion of relative entropy. It is very important. In particular, you can prove that S rho of sigma is larger or equal to zero, which might not be obvious at all from the way I wrote it. And this is a thing I will prove later. What's also nice is that in quantum field theory, entanglement entropy doesn't really exist. It is UV divergent if you try to compute it in a quantum field theory. But for some interesting reason, relative entropy is a well-defined finite quantity, even in quantum field theory. And this is another reason why it's nice. So essentially, all the UV divergences that plague entanglement entropy, they cancel once you compute relative entropy, and you're left with a finite number, even in quantum field theory. A second notion is something called the modular Hamiltonian. Which in the quantum mechanical case, it is just an operator that appears if you write the reduced density matrix as the exponent of another operator. So this is not a very profound definition. It is simply the statement that HA is minus log rho A. But this does have a different name. Also, in quantum field theory, where this definition does not work, one can still define this thing called the modular Hamiltonian. And it's quite an interesting object in quantum field theory. But in quantum mechanics, this is all there is to it. And what we're basically doing here is we sort of try to interpret the density matrix in some formal sense as a thermal state for a suitable Hamiltonian. So if you take beta equals one unit temperature, and you take for the Hamiltonian of your system, you take to be minus the logarithm of the density matrix rho A, of the state rho A, then rho A becomes a finite temperature state. It is just like as if it were a thermal state, but not with respect to some given Hamiltonian, but with respect to this weird Hamiltonian HA. So any state rho A can be reinterpreted as a finite temperature state associated to some peculiar Hamiltonian. And this peculiar Hamiltonian may have nothing to do with the Hamiltonian of the system you're looking at. It is a completely separate operator, not to be confused with the Hamiltonian. And generically, even in quantum mechanical systems, if you compute this particular HA, it will be a horrible non-local operator. It will not look like a regular Hamiltonian at all. And it's almost never explicitly computable. The only exceptions are basically free field theories and certain simple spin chains where for given subsystems A, one can in fact explicitly compute HA. But it's highly unlikely that HA is something simple and local. There are a few examples in quantum field theory that are very important and fundamental where HA turns out to be an interesting local operator, and I will describe those later in the lecture. Then there is the so-called Rennie entropies. That have an index n. They're called Rennie entropies. So this is just some definition. Notice that this involves so in principle, this can be defined for non-integer n, but normally we define it simply for n equals 2, 3, 4, dot, 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 dot. And what's different from entanglement entropy is that here you don't have a logarithm of rho A appearing. And that's nice because if you give me some very complicated rho A, it is very annoying to compute its logarithm, but it's very easy to compute the square of that big matrix with itself. Yeah, it's much more difficult to compute the logarithm of a large matrix than to compute an integer power of a large matrix. And this gives rise to something which is called the replica trick. Why I use the word replica is maybe not clear right now, but the replica trick is based on the mathematical statement that if you compute these Rennie entropies, and if you would be able to compute these Rennie entropies for arbitrary real values of n, not just for integer n, then it's not so difficult to see that if you take the limit where n goes to one of SNA, you recover the ordinary entanglement entropy of A. Yeah, to do this, we write for example, you can write it as rho A times rho A to the n minus one is rho A times e to the n minus one log rho A. And then you can do a series. Now you can clearly see how you would do a series expansion of this around n equals one. You just expand the exponential. The leading term in this series will just be rho A, but the trace of rho A is one and the log of rho A vanishes, so that does not contribute. And the next term that contributes is the first order term in this n minus one that pulls down a logarithm And if you put that all together, you see that if you take this limit, you get precisely the trace minus the trace of rho times log rho. This is roughly how it goes. So I'll leave this as a little exercise to figure out how this goes precisely, but it's straightforward with this little hint that I gave you. These are called the Rennie entropies. Now, the trick to try to compute entanglement entropy, this is called the replica trick. Why is it called the replica trick? That is because if I want to compute trace rho A to the N, one thing that you can do is take N copies of the original system. You take N copies of the original system. So let's write down what rho A to the N means. Let me just write down what rho A squared is so that it becomes easier to see. So the trace of rho A squared is a sum over I rho A J, J rho A I. And similarly, if you do trace rho A to the cube, there's a K here, and then you get K rho A I, I J K. And now you see that in order to compute trace rho A cube, you need to do a sum over three copies of the Hilbert space. A sum over I, a sum over J, and a sum over K. Sorry. So we do a sum over three copies of the Hilbert space. So if you want, we take three copies of the original system, the replicas. That's where the word replica comes from. We replicate the original system a couple of times. And then in each of those systems, we compute, in each of these three systems, we compute these matrix elements, and then we glue them together in this way. And that produces for us the trace of rho A cube. So by replicating the system, taking copies of the system and gluing these system, these copies together in the very particular way as given here, we compute trace rho A cube. And similarly, we can compute trace rho A to the N for all integer N using this replication technology. We just replicate the system a bunch of times and glue them together in a very specific way as given by this particular expression. So with this replica trick, so now how in many cases, how do we go about in order to try to compute entanglement entropy? So practical. Is first we compute Sn of A for n equals 2, 3, 4... using this replica trick. So we just take n copies of our quantum mechanical system, we glue them together in the way I just described, and we compute trace rho A to the n for integer n. And from that we compute these Rennies for integer n. So that's the first step. And this is often relatively easy to do because all that you need is to take a bunch of copies of your system, glue them together and take traces. In fact, people in experimental physics that work with cold atoms, when they say that they are measuring entanglement entropy in the lab, they're not really measuring entanglement entropy. But typically, if people that do cold atom experiments claim that they have measured some entanglement, they usually mean that they measured the second Rennie. And what it means is that they just took two copies of their atomic lattices, and they then tuned the boundary conditions in such a way that you precisely glue those two atomic chains together in this way. And in this way, you can compute trace rho A squared of the density matrix of a single atomic chain, for example, of a single system of cold atoms. It's not just a theoretical tool, it's also like an experimental, something that's experimentally implementable. But theoretically, it is typically much easier to compute these integer powers of rho to the a and their traces using this representation and this so-called replica trick rather than doing it directly with brute force. Now, the second thing we need is we need to find an analytic continuation of these numbers, so that we now have Sn of A, where n is just some real number larger than one, I suppose. And then once we have this analytic continuation, we can now take the limit where n goes to one, and we can compute S of A. So this is in practice how you can go about computing entanglement entropy using what's known as the replica trick. There is a subtlety here because we are analytically continuing something that is only defined at integers. And there is in general no unique analytic continuation of a function that is only given by values at integers. Moreover, it can be difficult to find that particular analytic continuation. It may not be easy to find that analytic continuation. In simple cases, typically an analytic continuation stares you in the face, but in general it might be hard to find. And there are two possible issues with this analytic continuation. The first possibility that is annoying is if there is basically a phase transition in N. Which means that the function isn't really analytic as a function of N. And if that's the case, then there's no useful analytic continuation. This can happen, a situation where it happens goes in the name of replica symmetry breaking, and it appears, for example, in spin glasses and things like that, but I won't worry about this particular possibility. And two, the analytic continuation is not unique. And the analytic continuation may not be unique. For example, it's easy to write down an analytic function, say sine pi x, which vanishes at every integer. So if you find an analytic continuation and you add sine of pi of x to it, then that's also a perfectly okay analytic function, which has exactly the same values at n equals 2 and 3 and 4 and so on. So typically, what one does, however, sine pi of x has the property that it behaves rather badly in the complex plane because this grows like e to the pi. It grows like e to the pi y when you write x as x naught plus I y. So if you go off along the imaginary axis, sine pi of x grows rapidly, the absolute value. So it grows exponentially. So typically, that's not what you want. So normally what you do is when you analytically continue, you try to find an analytic continuation, which does not grow as fast as e to the pi y as you go off along the imaginary axis. This is a bit of a technical point, but this question sometimes comes up, so that's why I'm briefly discussing it. And there's even a theorem that says, it's called Carlson's theorem. So Carlson's theorem states that if you have a function that is given at n equals 2, 3, 4, etc., it has one unique analytic continuation that grows slower than this along the imaginary axis. So if you impose this as an extra condition, then there is a unique analytic continuation. And that's typically the one that we're interested in physics, although I don't know a general proof of that statement. if you, however, look at the definition of the Rennie and you look at how it behaves, how this quantity here behaves when n goes off into the imaginary axis, there's no reason for that to grow exponentially. Because now we get real eigenvalues to some imaginary power that is some oscillatory behavior. So intuitively, for a generic situation, you would not imagine Rennie entropies to grow rapidly as you go off along the imaginary axis. So with this extra technical assumption, this analytic continuation becomes unique and this whole procedure becomes well-defined. Yes. Any questions about this discussion of Rennie entropies and analytic continuation?
Can you say the name again of this theorem that you mentioned?
Yeah, good, sure. It's called Carl, I think two S's. Maybe one S, I'm always confused.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe one S. So now I'm going to prove for you one particular inequality for relative entropy, which is one of these things that is still kind of interesting, but we can still prove using fairly elementary methods and doesn't require too much sophisticated math. So I'm going to prove an inequality for relative entropy. Some inequality for relative entropy. And to prove that, we're going to start with a function. We are going to consider the following function. So it's x times log x minus log y minus x minus y minus 1/2 x minus y squared. So this is just a function of two variables. And I claim that f is larger or equal than 0 when 0 is less or equal than x comma y, which is less or equal than 1. And I leave that for you to prove. This is just analysis. It's pretty simple, but you can just compute the derivatives of f and find where its minima are and make a little plot. And then you will see that indeed what I said is true. This function is non-negative for any x and y which are between 0 and 1. Now let's take a state rho, which is a sum. So I'm going to assume I chose a basis in which these density matrices are diagonal. Such a basis always exists. So here are two completely arbitrary density matrices written in a basis in which they are diagonal. These are two different bases. So the basis of states psi I of the Hilbert space is a completely different basis than the basis chi j, because they're just two completely independent density matrices, rho and sigma. Now consider the following. So here, this first thing here is a one-dimensional projector. This is also a one-dimensional projector. And I just multiply them together. And suppose that I now write rho log sigma here. What is this quantity? Well, if you insert rho here and you multiply it with this particular projector and you multiply rho, the psi i's are orthogonal, right? They were a basis. It's an orthonormal basis in which rho is diagonal. So if I multiply this projector by rho, it only picks up the piece lambda I from rho. So this only picks up the piece lambda I from rho. So this will mean that this whole combination here will simply reduce to lambda I psi I psi I. And similarly, we have a log of sorry, I wanted to actually do a different case. My apologies. So suppose this is sigma. This log of sigma, if you expand it, it is just given by sigma. But instead of mu of j, we have the log of mu of j. Moreover, the trace is cyclic, right? You can move things around through the trace. So if we move this logarithm to the front here, and we multiply the logarithm of sigma with this chi j, it becomes the log of mu j times chi j. So the whole thing becomes the trace of log of mu j and times lambda i. So the rho and the sigma are gone, and they're basically replaced by their corresponding eigenvalues, lambda I and log mu j. And for the rest, nothing much has happened. So this is equal to lambda I times the log of mu j times simply the trace of these two projectors. But taking the trace of this of these two projectors together just spits out the absolute value psi I chi j absolute value squared, right? By just taking the inner product. So what happens is if you take, let me say again what happened here. So if you take a projector one and you take a projector two and you multiply it by this combination of density matrices, what you get is always this norm of these things squared times the relevant eigenvalues. Now we can repeat this for all kinds of other combinations. And this leads to the following statement. Let me put a bracket here, minus rho minus sigma minus a half rho squared minus two rho sigma plus sigma squared. If I do exactly what I just did, I just illustrated it with one term in here, But if I apply the same trick to all the other terms that I have here, what this becomes is precisely and now times lambda I log lambda I minus the log of mu j minus minus lambda I minus mu j minus 1/2 lambda I minus mu j squared. So this particular funny combination that I have here in this box, if I do the trick I just illustrated, it becomes the absolute value squared of some inner product times a combination of lambda I and mu j. But now if you go back to my little algebraic inequality that I had, which was the function f, I told you that this weird function f is just some analytic function. It is positive whenever x and y are between 0 and 1. And what you see here is that this is precisely equal to psi I chi j squared times this function f of lambda I and mu j. It's precisely that combination that I introduced before that appears when I do this particular thing. And now we know that this is larger or equal 0 because f was non-negative. And obviously the inner product square is also non-negative. So that means that the thing in the box, that means that this thing must be larger or equal to 0. So it's a little trick. We took some combination of density matrices. We cleverly multiplied it with some projectors and out came precisely a nice function of the eigenvalues that we happen to know is non-negative. And therefore this entire thing is non-negative. But now let's take the thing in the box and let's now sum over I and j. As you see, I and j only appear in these projectors in the beginning of this box. But for the rest, there's just some rho and sigma there. And if you sum over, well, that is just the resolution of the identity. If you sum over psi I in this way, you just get the identity operator. So if we take this thing in the box, which was non-negative, and we sum over all I and all j, it will obviously remain non-negative. But now these all the states that appear, they just get replaced by identity operators. So we're left with the following statement. We are left with the following statement. And now this is a statement, some inequality for density matrices. Now the trace of a density matrix is always equal to 1. That's a property of density matrices. So in fact, this rho and the sigma, they cancel each other because those traces just give 1. And therefore, if we rewrite what's written here, we also recognize in the beginning here, this combination that was relative entropy. So the conclusion that we have is the following sharp inequality. Well, let me write it slightly in a slightly better way, just to not introduce new notation. So here is an example of an inequality that we have now proven. And what this inequality tells us, what it implies, first of all, it implies that, relative entropy is non-negative. This was not an obvious statement, but now we have proven it. So we have proven that relative entropy is non-negative. So in particular, S rho sigma, that's a weaker statement than this. But we have not only proven that it's non-negative, we also have given a lower bound for it. Now, the right-hand side of this inequality, this trace rho minus sigma squared, this can only be equal to zero if rho is equal to sigma. Because if rho minus sigma is non-zero, then the trace of its square will always be non-zero. So we also see that S rho of sigma equals zero is equivalent to rho equals sigma. And that means that that somehow S, this relative entropy, S of rho and sigma, it is a measure for to what extent rho and sigma are equal to each other. Because we see that it vanishes when rho is equal to sigma, and otherwise it's always positive. So relative entropy is a quantum information theoretic object that somehow quantifies how different rho and sigma are from each other. That's what it quantifies.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I think you said earlier that S rho sigma was anti-symmetric. So can the value vary quite a lot depending on the order you put rho and sigma, and how does that affect this interpretation?
Yeah, so it's a strange quantity because it's indeed not symmetric. So it's not a symmetric, it's not a notion of distance between rho and sigma, because that would be symmetric. So it really is an asymmetric object that somehow distinguishes rho and sigma. If your question is, are there examples where S of rho and sigma is really very, very different from S of sigma rho, then I'm afraid I don't have the answer to that question. I think in many practical situations, S rho sigma and S sigma rho are not too different. You also see that this lower bound, for example, is symmetric in rho and sigma. But I don't know whether it's easy to engineer a situation where S rho sigma is very different from S sigma rho and what that means. I don't know the answer to that question. I would have to think about it. Right.
Thank you.
Thank you. So maybe I can give an application of this thing. So in particular, one particular application of this inequality is to consider S. We can do a very special case. Suppose we take a state on a system AB, and we call it rho AB. And suppose we take the reduced density matrices of rho AB on subsystem A and on subsystem B. And we call those reduced density matrices rho A and rho B as usual. And then we compare the original state, rho AB, to the tensor product of rho A and rho B. We're just comparing these two states. We are going to look how different they are. And you might imagine that this relative entropy that I just defined is going to be also some sort of measure of entanglement, because it is going to compare rho AB to the state rho A tensor rho B. Now, rho A tensor rho B does not have any correlation between A and B. So if the original state rho AB was in fact the tensor product of rho A times rho B, then this thing obviously vanishes, and then there is indeed no correlation. But if rho AB does have correlation between A and B, it cannot be equal to the tensor product rho A tensor rho B. Therefore, this quantity must be non-zero and presumably is some measure for how much entanglement there is between rho AB and rho A tensor rho B. So let's expand a little bit what this inequality means, and then we'll see it's something that we have seen before. Because if we expand this inequality, so we just write it out explicitly. Looks something like this. Now we need to figure out what the logarithm of the tensor product of two matrices is. Well, that's a nice little computation. Which I will leave for you to think about, because it's essentially an almost trivial computation that is always a bit subtle with matrices. So this is the answer. This is the matrix version of the statement that the logarithm of xy is the logarithm of x plus the logarithm of y. And the matrix version of that statement is this particular statement here. If you plug this answer for the logarithm in the line above, then we get in particular combinations that look like this. Yeah, this is a combination that you get when you replace this logarithm by what I just wrote and you plug it into the line above. But now remember that what was the fundamental definition of reduced density matrices? It was the thing that if you have an operator that acts non-trivially in a subsystem A and does not do anything in a system B, this was precisely all the way at the beginning how we defined a reduced density matrix. So this is the same as trace rho A log rho A by the definition of reduced density matrix. Yeah, so these two things are equal to each other. So if you then go back to this equation star here and you plug everything in and you work it out, then what we get is that the trace of rho AB log rho AB minus rho A log rho A minus rho B log rho B is not largely equal zero. But now this is just a bunch of ordinary entanglement entropies. So what stands here is the statement that SA plus SB minus SAB is largely equal zero, which was precisely the statement that the mutual information was non-negative. So we now have proven reliably that mutual information is non-negative, which was equivalent to subadditivity, which was, this statement was also known as subadditivity. So we have now reliably proven that mutual information is non-negative. For this, we did not even need the strongest form of the inequality. We could also have given a sharper inequality by using the full inequality here, but that was not needed. So you can see that just the statement that relative entropy is non-negative is already a reasonably powerful statement, because if you apply it to a special situation, you find that mutual information is non-negative. Now there is an important theorem which states that relative entropy is monotonic. And it's the following statement. So this is an important fundamental inequality for relative entropy. And it's maybe pretty intuitive if you translate it in more intuitive language. It is the statement that if you start with two states on a larger system and you compare them to each other, they are more different than when you first go to a subsystem and you compare them there. So on the left, we have rho A and sigma A. Those are the reduced density matrices on subsystems. And because you basically, by going to a subsystem, you throw away information that you had. Obviously, the full states, rho AB and sigma AB, they have more information, they contain more information in themselves than rho A and sigma A do. Therefore, it should be easier to distinguish rho AB and sigma AB in the larger AB system than in the subsystem A. And that's precisely the intuition behind this equation. It's a quantitative version of that statement. It says that rho AB and sigma AB, the two states in the larger system, they're always essentially more different than the reduced density matrices rho A and sigma A, where you go to a subsystem and you compare the states from the perspective of a subsystem. So this is a fairly intuitive statement if you phrase it like this. It is simply the statement that if you throw away information, things start to look more alike. It's almost like a renormalization group / coarse graining type of statement. But the proof is kind of complicated. This is one of these things that, as you may recall, how I proved my little inequality for relative entropy here. I used a bit of algebra and some inequalities, but the starting point was just an inequality for a function. You can get other inequalities with the same technology. You start with a function of two variables and then you write inequalities and then you stick in projectors and you grind away. And that gives you some inequalities, but it will never give you this monotonicity of relative entropy. This is a more sophisticated inequality. It's probably also a more important inequality. In particular, this particular inequality, it implies strong subadditivity. That's a fairly trivial consequence of this inequality. We have proven subadditivity above. That was simple, that we could prove by elementary means. Strong subadditivity, let's see where was this inequality, somewhere up here. Yeah, number three here was strong subadditivity. So we have proven two by elementary means, but three is a more difficult statement, strong subadditivity. It was also not intuitive at all at this particular moment in the lecture where this strong subadditivity came from. But it turns out that strong subadditivity is just a special case of this fundamental inequality. You just have to find a suitable choice of rho AB and sigma AB that involve, for example, rho AB is, you now replace rho AB by rho AB tensor rho C and sigma AB by rho A tensor rho BC and so on. And you grind, you just stick some suitable states in this and you manipulate an outcome strong subadditivity. So this non-transparent statement of strong subadditivity is a special consequence of this more intuitive statement that when you compare states on subsystems, you have less information and they're more alike than when you compare states on the bigger system. So that's strong subadditivity. Let me see, how much time should I have? Do I have? Can I have?
How much would you need for today?
Well, maybe I could try to make one more point.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, sure. Yeah, we started also a bit late. Please.
Yeah, so there's one more point maybe I can try to make. That's the following. Suppose we consider a thermal state. So we always have to put in this normalization factor Z in order to make sure that the trace of the thermal state is equal to one. Otherwise, it's not a mixed state in quantum mechanics. So this is the thermal state. Now let's consider the following inequality. The relative entropy between any state and the thermal state should be non-negative. Now, if you work this out a little bit, so this Z is slightly annoying in this computation. But if you work it out, you get the following statement. You get, if you expand this statement that I just made, and I'll leave it as a brief exercise to check what I'm about to say now, but it's pretty straightforward, is let's define the following combination. Then F is larger or equal to this number. This is just a number. That's why this Z is a bit annoying. This is the minimum value of F. And it precisely takes its minimum value when rho is equal to the thermal state. And F is also known as the free energy. In fact, if you stare a little bit at this combination here, the first term here is like the energy, right? It's the expectation value of the Hamiltonian in the state rho. So it's like the energy. Beta minus one is like the temperature, and S is the entropy. So this looks like E minus TS. And that's precisely what we normally call the free energy. Except now we defined free energy for any state rho. And the statement that we have now is that if you define the free energy for any state rho, this free energy is bounded from below and the free energy is minimal, is minimized in the thermal state. So these are all statistical mechanical statements, slightly rephrased in a more maybe quantum information theoretic language. But we have simply stated this fact that the free energy is bounded from below and its minimum is obtained when you're in the thermal state. And here is a definition of free energy for any state. So the free energy is minimal in the thermal state. So let's now go to a system. I'm going to look at the system AB. And I'm going to take the thermal state on the system AB. So it's going to be E minus beta H AB. divided by a suitable Z. Since the free energy is minimized for the thermal state, which is the statement made here, we know that if I take the thermal state as defined here, and I compare it to the free energy of any other state, say rho A tensor rho B, this inequality must hold because again, the free energy is minimized for the thermal state. So here this rho A and rho B are the reduced density matrices of this thermal state. Now let's work this out a little bit and let's assume let's assume that the full Hamiltonian of the system consists of a piece that lives purely in A and a piece that lives purely in B. And then there's going to be a term H sub delta, which is the term in the full Hamiltonian that couples the system A and B. If you, for example, imagine a spin chain or some discrete system, and we have system A and B here, and we have only nearest neighbor interactions, then this here, then this here will be part of HA. This interaction will be part of HA. This interaction will be the boundary interaction that connects A and B. And then this will be HB, and this will also be HB. Now, this here above is the definition of F. And I'm going to use that definition and I'm going to plug it into this statement here. That leads to the following statement. So this is the free energy for the thermal state as defined above. It was traced rho times the Hamiltonian, and I'm expanding the Hamiltonian precisely in the way that I described. And then this must be less or equal to the same thing, but now where we use trace rho A tensor rho B times the same Hamiltonian. Minus beta inverse times the entropy of this tensor product thing, but that's just the sum of the two. If you have the product of two density matrices and you compute the entanglement entropy of that product, it's just the sum of the two things. Yes, one can easily check. So this is the inequality that we get. Now, what do we have? First of all, you recognize this combination here, which except for the beta inverse is the same combination that appears in mutual information. So there's a piece here, which is mutual information. And next thing that we know is that the trace of HA in this state, so that's an operator that lives in a subsystem. And again, if we have an operator that lives in a subsystem, we can always replace the state by the corresponding reduced density matrix. And the same is true in the second line. This HA lives in a subsystem. We can replace this state also by the reduced density matrix. But both states have the same reduced density matrix, rho A. Because rho A by definition was the reduced density matrix that you get from the thermal state. But it's also trivially the reduced density matrix you get from the product state. So that means that this term and this term cancel each other. And similarly, the B terms cancel each other. What does not cancel is this little boundary Hamiltonian piece. So if we assemble what is left and we remove the beta to the other side, etc., we get the following. You get the following inequality. So this is the final equation I will write today. So what does this inequality say? It says that the mutual information, which is a measure for the amount of entanglement between A and B in a finite temperature situation, is bounded by the expectation value of the boundary Hamiltonian in some state in the difference of these two states. So the only thing mutual information cares about is the boundary Hamiltonian. It did not care about HA, it did not care about HB, it only cares about the fact that you have an interaction between A and B. And this Hamiltonian on the boundary, it also puts a bound on mutual information. And this is basically the original version of a proof of the so-called area law. As it was first pointed out in a paper by, I think, Sirac and Verstraete and others. This basically shows that in a finite temperature system, the amount of entanglement is controlled by the interactions between the systems. So if you have like a system A and a system B, it's only these little interactions that create entanglement at finite temperature. All the other interactions in the system are not important. And if you then estimate this right-hand side in terms of the eigenvalues of H delta, this H delta will be some local interaction across the interface. But you can sort of see why, if you do this in a discrete system, why this would tell you that this I is going to be less or equal to some constant times the area between A and B. Because all the entanglement at the end of the day from in this expression, it comes exclusively from this narrow region near the interface. The rest is irrelevant. And that's why mutual information and more general entangling properties between systems A and B, they typically obey an area law, not a volume law. So entanglement entropy, although we use the word entanglement and we use the word entropy, entropy normally is an extensive quantity. It scales with the volume. But from that point of view, entanglement entropy is really totally different from standard entropy, because entanglement entropy typically obeys an area law, and that's illustrated by this computation. And that's a very, very important difference between all these entangling quantities and standard extensive entropy from statistical mechanics. Now, so quite interesting that you get an area law. As you may know, the entropy of a black hole is also determined by its area. And therefore you might start to say, which is very strange, you might think it should go with the volume of the black hole, but this famous Bekenstein-Hawking entropy is proportional to the area, not the volume. So this might lead you to suspect that there might be a deeper connection between black hole physics with its area law for entropy and these types of quantum information theoretic things that also give an area law rather than a volume law. That sounds very intriguing and interesting, but ultimately this is not quite what the right interpretation of black hole entropy is, but it's certainly, there's certainly some connection, but ultimately this intuition is not quite on the money, I think. But it certainly was, I think, one of the original interests in looking at entanglement and entanglement entropy in the context of gravitational physics. And that's all for today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Jan, for the lecture. So I guess I will first of all pause the, or actually stop the recording.